was an experience of expecting death. So that that took some time to talk through and work through for myself.
Three houses at 145th Avenue and 19th Street were blown over. There were reports of people being trapped.
We have an awful lot of improving to do in our systems associated with handling weather catastrophes.
We wanted to get through the summer. We know that any anniversary date is again a time where kids start to shake and get nervous.
I can't believe what I'm seeing. This is just amazing.
Right through? I've got right through to the back from the belly. There's nothing in there that I can find. There's no answers.
It's been said that in times of trouble, the true strength of a person shows through. But is that possible, even in the face of something hugely powerful and enormously destructive? July 31st, 1987. Edmontonians were faced with an incredible disaster. Tonight, we'll find out how some of them are doing after a year of fear. It was an enormous disaster, the like Edmonton has never before experienced. The images from that day 1 year ago fill most people's minds now. What was I doing when it hit? How did I feel when I saw the first pictures carried on television? Even now, there are reminders of Black Friday. Out here south of the industrial park, twisted and broken remnants are scattered everywhere. Most of the debris is gone now from the city. The reminders have been destroyed. Yet it's almost impossible to remove the memories from people's minds. Memories that create new fears about it happening again.
We all ran downstairs. We stayed down there for a long time. When we come upstairs, we looked outside. We heard sirens. We saw a house with no roof and a house with even more damage. My mom said we were lucky we never got hit.
The day after, I phoned my friend's mom, and she told my mom that my friends died in the tornado, and so did their dad and their dog.
I missed my mom and dad. I was worrying about my dog and my birds and my house. I was scared. I hope there's never a tornado again.
The children from Fraser Elementary School in Clairview read us their letters and showed us their drawings. When talking about life and death matters, a child can say it simply and honestly. And sometimes the kids are hardest hit by such an emotional disaster as caused by the 1987 tornado.
It's a safe place, and I think that's the key to it. It's a safe, happy place.
Fraser School Principal Ted Coxford and his staff picked up on the unease that surfaced in their friendly, happy school.
A lot of adults tend to, I suppose, try to protect kids, but they don't want to talk about it, and I say they want to protect them, but children need to talk. And we noticed a lot of the children here were having a hard time, as were the adults.
So everyone's parents know about Happy then, hey?
The children were introduced to Donna Devlin and her puppet friend, Happy. Donna is a stress management counselor with community and occupational health. Her challenge was to draw out emotions from the children that might otherwise tear them apart.
It's okay to cry, isn't it? And does it feel better when you cry?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
The kids write to him, and it's actually amazing the kinds of things that are revealed through their writing. They really spill their guts.
The children successfully learn not to withhold their feelings, not to try and keep it bottled up inside. But Happy wanted them to do one other thing.
And he wants you guys to share it with other people, too. With your mom and dad or neighbors, when you hear people saying that they don't want to talk about it, what are you going to tell them?
If you don't talk about it, you're going to get sick.
You're going to get sick, or it's going to make you worse, right?
The proof is in the pudding, and these children are proof that what we have done has worked.
Bye.
When adults are afraid of something, they seek information. Facts create understanding. Understanding provides some semblance of control.
I would like to welcome all of you here. We're just...
This is one of many meetings held this spring, doling out information about tornadoes. It was organized through an unprecedented cooperative effort between the Edmonton Board of Health, Alberta Social Services, and the Canadian Mental Health Association. The meetings were packed with people anxious to hear more about tornadoes, where they hit, why they form, what they are.
I expected that many people just by the way they explained to us what they wanted. And a lot of people expressed that they wanted to hear more about tornadoes, what causes them, and that we're just responding to what they've asked us to do.
Do those usually move in only one direction?
This is Joan McCall. On the day the twister hit, she was at a friend's home in the Evergreen Trailer Park, hoping to take pictures of what in the days leading up to Black Friday had been an incredible lightning display. Millie Murray, her son David, and Joan McCall watched as the storm thundered into the park. But none of them could anticipate the destruction they were about to witness.
And I happened to look to the south, and it was very black, and it was scary. And I said, something is happening over there.
And as we were going in the house, it was in the park then, and all the stuff that was torn up was flying by us. But we still did not know what this was.
I went to the back door to go in myself, and I saw the tornado. And I guess, I don't remember, but my friend said I had identified it as that. And it was just transfixed there.
Once the tornado had passed, Millie sent her teenage son David out into the park to find out what happened.
So Joan and I were out in the front just looking at the storm and stuff. And David came back and he was just hyper. He was just... gone. I said, I want you to go there and find from some authority what, in fact, we are to do. So I sent that poor kid back into that.
Those images, they are locked in our minds just from seeing it on TV. Imagine living it.
I've gotten over, but I'm still a little scared. You know, like, I don't want another tornado coming through. But I'm not as scared as some people are.
In the years since the tornado, Joan McCall has been trying to help others conquer the fears. It's not an easy task, rebuilding an emotional disaster area.
That was an experience of expecting death. So that took some time to talk through and work through for myself. So I think rebuilding happened in the midst of the pain, although they certainly didn't experience, none of us felt the rebuilding because we didn't think we could make it. And I mean, it was when months had gone by and you start dreaming. You start fearing the wind and seeing the tornado in your dreams.
When we're in a self-help group out here, you know, we all say, what are we really afraid of? And we're really afraid of that destruction, the taking of the lives, the innocence. There's no control. And that's what we're really afraid of, is the potential that each storm brings with it. And when we hear warnings and watches, that really scares us.
Some seem to be keeping it in. I have done my share of trying to get some of them to talk it out. And, you know, they feel that, well, others suffered greater than they did. And it's true, they did, but so you still need to look at what has affected you.
It seems fairly stationary. I've been here for about 10 minutes, and during this time it has traveled less than a half a mile. It is moving east at a very slow pace. It is still over a wooded area. However,
these dramatic pictures are from a relatively small tornado in Minnesota. But even a small twister is a powerful threat, ripping trees from the earth, snapping power poles. The tornado that hit Edmonton last July was huge, very powerful, and deadly. On the Fujita tornado intensity scale, it was a strong F3, sometimes approaching F4. An F5 tornado was virtually unheard of, occurring maybe once in 100 years in the entire world. How does a tornado form? This is a classic example. Overhead, a thunderstorm is developing. Warm, moist air from the ground surges up through the core of the system. As the rain begins to fall, it brings cool air rushing down and out from the storm. The result is updrafts and downdrafts swirling around each other. This kind of system will create high damaging winds, hail, and even a tornado.
I relive the tornado over and over again in my mind every time that there's wind, or I used to. I'm starting to get over that now. Now my fear is hot days, what it's going to be like. Am I going to have to live through the tornado again?
Sherry Marks and husband Henry know that based on facts, it's very uncommon for tornadoes to occur. But emotional stress does not deal with fact. It deals with feelings. And even little babies can be affected. Their son James had been sleeping in this crib just a few minutes before the tornado struck the Clairview area. Sherry and her baby were caught right in the middle of the storm. She protected James with her body. The house was crushed all around them. Yet they escaped with only cuts and bruises. Escaping from the memory of that day has been much harder.
He's getting better now.
He was
afraid of showers, the noise.
Water, period.
Yeah.
He was afraid of water, bath time and stuff afterwards, because we got rained on and the hail and the lightning and the thunder, the noise. And he's just starting to enjoy bathing now. He's still afraid of the shower. And he was afraid of the wind for the longest time. If you took him outside and it was the least bit windy, he got upset. You feel like you're the only one going through what you're going through, but believe me, you're not. There are hundreds of other people out there that are going through it also.
The Marks family spent 5 months living somewhere other than home. There are still pictures to be hung, a few kitchen articles left to buy, but their home is rebuilt. And tonight, the Marks are having a block party with neighbors in the Clairview district, celebrating the fact that they are still alive.
It's very unfortunate that there were some deaths in the other areas and stuff. But we feel that we have something to celebrate because we all did survive it. The ones who survived it were fortunate enough to survive, so we're going to party.
Anniversaries are often turning points. If people haven't dealt with their difficulties, it's often a painful experience. If people have been able to face their fears and anxieties, then it's often a very positive turning point and it becomes a milestone. I've coped well for a year, and you know, there's an expression, the first year is the worst, etc. And it will, I think, give them some hope.
We've been talking about rebuilding some of the emotional destruction from the 1987 tornado, and to an extent, rebuilding some of the physical destruction. Well, these trees and flowers are an example of how both are being restored. Replacing some of the destruction at the Evergreen Trailer Park was a project started by a teen support group, which itself began just a few weeks after the disaster.
We'll do it, especially right in the front here, maybe put two rows, and then along the sides, one, because this is where the people are going to be looking at our display.
Jeff Elliott is one of the group leaders. He and Kathy Robinson were hired by parents in the area to organize teens into a social group. The teens have handled the rest on their own. We met Dave Murray earlier in the program. He mentioned that he has gotten over the tornado. Well, this group is one of the reasons why.
You happy that group was there, or would you have made it without them?
I don't think I, well, I would made it without them, but I needed that extra momentum to carry me through. After the tornado, people were looking to catch on to someone to say, hey, yeah, I understand what you were through. I was through it too.
Tornadoes in Alberta are not rare, contrary to public perception. In 1986, 21 tornadoes were spotted in our province. What is rare is damage or loss of life. Since Alberta's population is so spread out, the chances of a twister touching down in a community or on a farm are very slim. But it does happen. Last year's Edmonton tornado was devastating proof, and this year it happened again. June 4th, in the evening hours, a huge storm swept northward through the heart of the province. Within that storm, a tornado. The destruction was frightfully reminiscent of Edmonton's tragedy 10 months earlier. But in this case, no lives were lost. What that storm did was drive home to everyone in Alberta that although dangerous tornadoes are uncommon, they are still a fact of life in our part of the country, and steps have to be taken for protection.
Last July 31st, one of the things that upset me was that I didn't know it was coming. Like, perhaps, you know, this year has given us awareness of what a tornado can do, what a tornado really is.
There were problems of communication, and I think it's part or mostly due to the fact that the tornado is such a rapidly changing event. Everything is happening so quickly, and once it becomes apparent to the media and to the public that this is a serious event that's affecting the city, then telephone lines get jammed. It becomes impossible for the media to call the weather office to obtain updated information on where it is and where it's headed.
Dr. Keith Haig was asked by Environment Canada to use his expertise in dissecting what had happened and make recommendations on how to improve the systems. Dr. Haig found three areas lacking. Communications, mostly between the weather office and the media, needed improvement. Forecasting equipment at Environment Canada's Edmonton office required updating. And public awareness had to be raised.
Thank you, Dale.
The scope of the July tornado, the many lives it touched, instantly increased public awareness. The rest was up to the weather office.
We've put into place some new computer facilities. We'll be, in the next little while, adding new radar data processing over the next couple of years. So we've made several major improvements.
This system dramatically improves communications between the weather office and the media. Information through this receiver is constantly updated so that radio and television can keep the public up to date.
A weak Pacific disturbance crossing British Columbia will enter the western forecast.
The weather office will broadcast two kinds of advisories, watches and warnings. A watch means to prepare for the possibility of severe weather. The system is still a couple of hours away, but there is a possibility of serious storms. A warning means the system is here right now. So if you hear a severe thunderstorm watch or a tornado watch, that means stay alert and wait for more information. A warning means take action to protect yourself immediately. It's virtually impossible to predict where a tornado will touch down or for radar to pick up a tornado. So the weather office relies on eyewitness reports of severe weather.
We have between 600 and 800 weather watchers across the province, and they have been specially trained and will phone in on a volunteer basis when they see something they've been trained to identify and give us some advance warning.
The cloud at this point was tracking to the northeast.
Tom Taylor is a weather watcher. Last July 31st, he was the first to spot the tornado and report it.
And as I watched it, the belly of the cloud slumped and then a huge funnel dropped out of the cloud over in the area of Beaumont. It was down on the ground in a matter of seconds.
Hello!
Firefighters, ambulance drivers, police officers, all were involved in the search for victims and in helping the injured.
I'm Bruce Wilson, the emergency planning officer for the city of Edmonton, and we have some...
It occurred to Bruce Wilson and his team at Edmonton Disaster Services that most people have no idea what to do in case of emergency. Dialing 911 isn't much help when a tornado is outside your back door. The problem faced by disaster services was somehow the information had to be at people's fingertips. Since almost everyone has a phone, they also have a phone book. And information vital to a person's survival is contained in this year's edition. Tornadoes are specifically dealt with on page 44 of the Edmonton White Pages directory. One year ago today, the lives of hundreds, thousands of people were turned inside out. 27 people were killed by one storm. The images from that tragic day, that's what most people are trying to come to grips with on this anniversary day. Across the fields in Clairview, Henry and Sherry Marks are having a block party with their neighbors, celebrating the fact that they are still alive. In Evergreen, the Murray family and other residents have relived that day through memorial services and through their memories. They say, though, it is going to be much easier now.
It is a big time for us to go through, to live through that day, to know that we have made it, that we are no longer victims, but now we are survivors. And that is a major change in attitude that I have found out here.
And despite the horror of that day, some good things came out of it. A sense of community, strangers helping strangers. Those good memories will also remain embedded in the mind of Joan McCall.
I think that the focal point in the park where we met at the hall, the community hall and the rink there, kind of hold a special place for the people because that's where the community came together to rebuild. In all kinds of groups. The help was fantastic.
A year of fear is over. The emotional rebuilding process has begun. And now hope for the future can continue to grow.